Oh, it does work.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Yes, I'm Chris.
Hi, Chris.
We are SkiTech Astronomy. Nearly. This will take forever. We are almost all here. Greg and Margo had to hop on a train back to New York. Brian and Marcy and Violet have too many little kids and never left California. And Ben and Sarah and Todd.
They already left. I saw them on the train heading out to the airport.
Okay, so that's where they are. Okay. Otherwise, we're all here. And so everything that you've been doing for the last couple of days is what we've been sort of toiling over for the last couple of, 12 months. Our goal is to be brief and poignant. I will try not to cry, but we're a bunch of happy people, and I feel like I'm in a room full of happy people, so I'm really good about that. So our goal today is just kind of give you an overall sort of view of the hunt, some of the things that we got to see that you did for us, and things like that, and then talking about kind of what we were doing to put this together, and then give you a little chance to talk very briefly, if there are any minutes before 1 o'clock. And I think at that point, so if you look up there, here's another copy of it. The D2, because I'm obsessive compulsive about details, the D2 that was actually found was the one that was present in the actual opening skit. And really, at this point, I would like to introduce Jen and TK, the brain children. This is the brain child.
Parents.
They are the brain parents of this.
So when we came up with this idea, it actually started with a lot of talk about what we wanted out of structure. We were toying with different ideas for different ways you could unlock things. And there were a lot of ideas, which we will not tell you so that you can use them in future hunts, because we won't. But the one that developed into this idea was, what if you took a hunt that had a score, and there were multiple kinds of scores, so that you had puzzles that unlocked on different tracks and you could prioritize, did I want to work on this to unlock that, or do I want to work on this to unlock that? And we're like, what does this sound like? And it kind of sounded like a role-playing game with maybe one character with multiple stats or multiple characters of different classes. And then we got very excited because that's what we wanted to write.
Yeah, I mean, one thing that we also talked about was the capacity for there to be a smaller section of the hunt that was still very important to the rest of the hunt, but that would be its own sort of little entity that would be solvable by more folks. And that is sort of how the character section and the quest section came into being. So part of our goal was to have the characters be some, the character puzzles were for a little while before we started calling them character puzzles, we were calling them fish puzzles. So shout out to you guys. So all of the character puzzles were meant to be of, you know, smaller one or two level difficulty so that they were more easily accessible. And then we put in the events and the gaps as a stopgap so that, you know, theoretically, larger teams would not necessarily be able, you know, you wouldn't be able to just run all of the character puzzles in a row. You had to stop and either wait for an event to happen or a meta solve to happen in order for that to progress. But smaller teams could complete the entire character rounds and the character endgame, the character metas were easier, and still have that be a solid accomplishment. We were shooting for 30 teams to complete the character endgame, and we had 29. So, we were close. So, go ahead.
And then the other thing that we wanted to accomplish that we set out for, and we found a way to do this later on, is to ensure that when you finished the round, whether it was a character round or a quest round, there were still reasons for you to go back and actually solve the puzzles within that. That's where the idea that you would finish the hunt at level 140 came from, because that meant that you had to finish all but five of the character puzzles. And it's also where the items and the gold came from, because that gave you incentive to solve quest puzzles that you would not otherwise look at once you had finished the round. Once we started giving you items, we needed something to do with that. That's where the maniacal merchants came from. And so all of these things just came together, structure and theme, feeding back and forth with each other in order to produce this hunt.
I didn't know either at first. I was like, what are you looking at? Oh, there's a screen over there. So here are the three characters that you began with, beautifully played by our actors on stage in the opening, and the three other that you could acquire over the course through the events. 55 different teams in person rescued the linguist over the course of the weekend. So what we'd like to do now is to do essentially a kind of quick rundown of everything that was sort of in the hunt in terms of like the metas and structure. And I think Dan and Connor can sort of rapidly go through that.
We've got time for that, right?
Oh, it's going to be like half.
It only took like 15 hours to solve.
So first of all, over a few of the character metas. The fighter meta was written by Todd McClary. So a reminder with these character metas, what you were looking for was sort of a special attribute or ability that each character brought to the team. In the fighter meta, each word had a letter sequence of the form ABAA. You can see your answers here on screen. If you took the letter in between that, the B from that sequence, and then you ordered it by the length of the words, they were all uniquely unique lengths from 4 through 14, it spelled out 1-2 combo, which your fighter could use to vanquish various enemies. The wizard meta, written by Dan and I think Todd Radford is not here at the moment, is that right? So each of these puzzles, or each of these answers, was a description of some kind of spell in the Harry Potter universe. So repress memories, send flying, Wingardium Leviosa, not Leviosa, you know, read minds, legilimens, and if you just took the first letters of the spell titles in the Harry Potter universe, ordered as they were presented, it spelled out Owl Familiar that year. And then for the cleric meta, written by Roger Arkin, somewhere around. It was presented as two columns of answers. If you looked at the words, you know, in adjacent in the columns, they were one letter off from some operation piece, you know, spare ribs, funny bone, became spars, rims, and fanny, and ore. And if you took the letters, the replaced letters, or the new letters in those words, and just read across, it spelled out smart bombs, which is a nice little pun.
So now the MIT characters, the linguist, written by Greg Pliska and Guy Jacobson. You'll see that pair of names together a lot if you look through the hunt credits. Each of the answers can be rearranged and have one letter added to form a language. Since the linguist is interested in languages, you read those in the given order and it spells the answer Silver Tongue. The Economist by two Rogers of the Barkin and Ford varieties.
The Economist is interested in money, and therefore all of these things are things that appear on state quarters. And if you just take the abbreviations of those states and read them in order, the abbreviations together spell arcade game income, which would be in the form of quarters. And the chemist, why is my name? Oh, I helped tweak the answer, but mostly this is Connor. Each of these answers can be formed of a chemical element abbreviation, and then O, and then another chemical element abbreviation. Since the O is between the two elements, it makes sense to look for the element that is between the two elements. If you take the elements that, in terms of atomic number, are exactly in the middle between those two, you take those chemical element abbreviations, and they spell positive spin.
Now we'll cover the quest metas. So for the Despondent Dynast by Guy over here, there was this emperor who was the flavor text hinted very strongly with various visuals and tiles towards the game Mahjong. He's sad having lost one of his sons to distant lands, I think traveling somewhere. And each answer in this round is exactly 13 letters long. A winning hand in Mahjong consists of 14 tiles, and those consist of three melds, which are either, or four melds. Melds are three tiles, either a run, which in letters we interpret as, you know, consecutive letters in the alphabet, or three of a kind. And so you can break, and then one pair of tiles. So it's 12 from the four melds and one pair. You can break each of these answers into a winning Mahjong hand, but it is missing one unique letter. And if you end up taking those missing letters ordered in the order presented on the page, it tells you that what you need to do to cheer up this dynast is find a fourth so you can keep playing Mahjong. The Dismal Dungeon meta. You are searching for your lost love in this dark and dismal dungeon, it's very hard to navigate. Every answer in this round consisted of the letters in NEWS, the compass points. There were never two letters consecutively that weren't those directional letters. So you had something like Even Steven. What else was there? Stepsisters. Oh yes, stepsisters is the example right there. So what you would do, these were directions through this map that you were presented with. So you can find the stepsisters direction somewhere on here where you start on some tile, you go south, you hit a T, you go east, you hit a P, you continue on through it, and you end up ending on a C tile. If you take the starting tiles, they are uniquely the letters A through L, with the exception of skipping E, because that would have been misinterpreted as a direction. And the ending tiles, after ordering using that mechanism, spells out carry a torch, which will help you lead your way through the dismal dungeon. And there's a nice pun on the next level. The Thrilling Thespians, you're trying to ferret out an assassin, and you have to get into this Shakespearean troupe, and their great asset is that every performer is excellent at playing Romeo or Juliet or Mark Antony or Cleopatra. They can play any side of a romance, and you have to convince the director to let you into this troupe. So every answer, this one is again presented in two columns, stage left and stage right. All the stage left answers started with the letters A through E, and the stage right answers ended with the letters A through E. This presented to you a way of pairing up these answers. And if you paired them up like so, between the two answers, with the insertion of one letter, you would find a Shakespeare character. So Captcha and Lethargic gives you Hamlet, Dwarf Sumac, and Ethelred gives you Macbeth with the addition of a B. The hunt is over. Yeah, we've already done this. Yeah. And so when then ordered with A through E, you get the beautiful pun, I thought, I am by, iambic pentameter, and the sentence, I am by, that you have to tell the director if you're worthy. And then the broken bridge meta, there is this bridge that is vital to these townsfolk, and it is broken, so that it's impassable. Every answer in this round suggested a four-letter word, and if you got enough of these words, you would notice that these four-letter words were similar, sharing many similar letters. It is in fact a word ladder, a bridge in this case, that is missing a few planks. And if you identify the missing words in this word ladder, it ends up giving you the phrase huge duct tape roll, which you can use to fix the broken bridge.
For some of you, some of the other puzzles may have suggested other four-letter words. The Crafty Criminal, idea by me, made actually good by Roger. So in this, there is a city that has been taken over by a criminal mastermind. Emphasis, mastermind. It's actually the last word in the description of the meta. Each of these was a six-letter word followed by some other word, and all of the letters in the second word are letters in black or letters in white, and they are to be interpreted as a set of mastermind pegs telling you which letters are correct in the correct place or correct in the wrong place in the six-letter word. It turns out the only way to make a six-letter word or phrase that works with all of these is Pegman. The goal of the meta is to figure out who can show you around. Pegman is the name of the little like stick figure guy who helps you on Google Maps when you do Street View. So he'll help. The Modest Minstrels. I told you Greg and Guy would appear together a lot. So each of these puzzles was accompanied by a musical clip. Some of you may have seen an erratum, one of our few errata in the hunt, that initially we did not match correctly the puzzles and the clips. That was pointed out to us eventually by Galactic Trendsetters. Sorry if I got the first sound wrong. So we did fix that and announce it when we noticed it. The first three teams to complete the hunt did manage to solve the meta without that correction. So, good job. Each of the musical pieces turns out to be in a different mode. For anyone who doesn't know what that means, I most kind of know what it means. They're not in different keys, but the idea is a different position within the scale is sort of the tonal center of the piece. Is that accurate?
You gotta ask Greg.
Okay, yeah. Ask Greg. Greg, if you're watching, is this okay? Also, the thing I couldn't find when I tested it, there are finger cymbal hits in the piece on three different notes. So ordering by the mode and then taking the pieces in the scale that correspond to the notes where the finger cymbals are hit, and then indexing into these, coincidentally, all seven-letter answers, not coincidentally, you get the phrase, we don't toot our own horns, which both references they're being modest, but also these are their deep, dark secret is this is the Milli Vanilli of minstrels. The Curious Cube by Connor. The idea is there was, all these were six-letter answers, and they were all sort of fed into this dungeon map, and the idea was that each of them could be put in a unique way where they broke into these things that could be folded into cubes. Once you fold these into cubes, there is a unique way to combine them into one big 2x2x2 cube where the letters that where faces match. There were additionally these colors given to you where the colors matched. It is actually solvable uniquely without those colors. It is much harder that way. Once you do that, the top of the cube will read up, and the bottom of the cube will read down, so you know how to position it. And then when you read around one side and then the other, I see. Okay, three errata now. When you read around, it says Fermat's Lost Serum. We're not sure everybody understood why that was an appropriate answer. In the story for this, at some points, the fighter cuts the cube in half and it breaks into two cubes, but then reforms into one cube. Fermat's Lost Serum shows you that two cubes cannot be combined to form one cube. Math. Okay. Next. I did get everything on that, right? Okay. And finally, The Woeful Warlord by Brian Sybil, who is off on the West Coast. It turns out the war that the Warlord is participating in is four games of tic-tac-toe. You're given these positions of four-letter words. The first letters can be formed into a tic-tac-toe game, second, third, and fourth. In each of these, there is a person who can move next, I think it's always O moving next, who has to move a particular place to block, which consists of a what was not an X or an O in that word. So for example, in the first grid, O has to move next in the E, which corresponds to the E in evil. And then, expect more reaction for that. the X would then have to block by doing the K in kilo. If you read all the O's and then the X's, you get Elle King. For anyone who doesn't know, she is a pop rock artist who had a hit with X's and O's. Oh, I'm doing merchants? Okay. Also, the maniacal merchants. I don't think we're going to show each of these individually. The idea is you were collecting 40 items as you went, and potentially before you even hit the merchants, you may have noticed there were some patterns in some of them. For example, the ones shown up here, there are each of them contains exactly 5 vowels, all of which are the same. So there are categories that 5 items fit into, and they also have a natural ordering. In this one, it makes sense to do the A, E, I, O, and U. Show one more example. And then... What? Oh, is there not one? And for example, in this one, they're supposed to represent suits. There is hearts, spades, clubs, diamonds, and a Harlequin doll to be the Joker. And also there's an ordering inherent because there's one thing in one of them, 2, and then 3, and then 4, and then 5. So once you finally get to the maniacal merchants, you see these counters where there's a different merchant at each one who has a name like, oh, this is not, okay, this is not actually just by me, this is by me and a whole bunch of other people who will eventually make it onto the thing. But anyway, so for example, that was suitable Sarah, since the suit card suits are on it. Behind the counters, there were a series of 5 numbers. Those are indexes. indexes into the item names. When you read them in that order, they sell the very long meta answer, sell this useless junk and go on a shopping spree. Once you do that, everything in your inventory immediately disappears and is replaced by 6 super awesome items, which maybe you have a slide for, you don't have a slide for, which are things like the Bunsen burner plus 3, and the cursed Bunsen burner minus 1, and the wicked cursed broadsword minus 7, and other things. Those will come in handy later.
I guess I'm talking again. All right, I am very, very proud of this slide. This slide features the, on the left-hand side, in order, the 17 different teams that made it entirely all the way through the hunt. Ranging from 15 hours for Death and Mayhem to nearly all the hours in the hunt, which I don't feel like doing math right now for left for an exercise reader. And in the second column, there are the 12 additional teams that made it all the way through the character endgame as well. Putting us at 29 to make it to a final, one short of our goal, But I just want to sort of say this now. One of our team things is, like, hopefully all of you saw us a lot, either coming to us or you, or us going to you over and over again. And sort of like the joy, whether it was solving a puzzle, solving a character meta, or getting through and entirely solving an entire puzzle hunt, like, brought a lot of teams some sort of tremendous joy. And there are a lot of people who are at the hunt this year who've been doing this for as long as I have, and some longer, who really had sort of like their first, like, I got to see a whole hunt experience, and I said I wouldn't cry. But I'm very happy about these things. No idea what's up next slide. So here's some. Well, so this Matt made these cute little graphics this morning. So on the axis here is the finish time. So the This is a vertical axis. There we go. I teach math, by the way. Just
for now.
Is the correct answer ratio percentage of the things that you called in. And the size of your bubble is the size of your team. So, it's an interesting data visualization. All right, let's look at the next one, and I need to stop. All right, this is for the character end game. So this is the one where 29 teams made the same sort of thing. When they did it, how accurate they were, and the size of the circle. But notice some interesting sort of things, like, you know, there are some big teams that took a long time, and look at those little circles that made it all the way through. And I don't see any pattern here at all. Read into that what you will. All right, next slide. All right, I didn't want to talk this much today. All right, these were the puzzles that were solved by most teams. I want you to look at that top number. That puzzle was solved by 74 different teams. And so, Swifties. Oh, don't worry, we'll let you know. I'm so happy that so many people got to see things. And I would also strongly suggest, since you now have, you know, lives to return to, but some free time, I hope, you should go back and look at a lot of those things. Most of those character puzzles were designed to be a half hour or hour type solve puzzle. I mean, 150 people might be able to get it in 6 minutes, but, you know, if you printed it out and, like, hung out with a loved one and had the TV on in front of you, you could have an enjoyable moment and work on a puzzle. So that's how you should feel about the character puzzles. That being said, China Kilns, not so much as character as the other. All right. And welcome to the other extreme. Also, I would like to point out that at the end of this meeting, we will put live all the solutions to everything for anyone who is sitting here wondering. Yeah, our team philosophy is you're not even allowed to submit a puzzle unless you submit the solution with it, because...
highly recommend it.
So... These were some challenging puzzles, but I sort of want to read down this, like...
It's hysteria!
Magic. Yeah, reminds me of my first LSC movie. I saw The Piano Here. Worst movie experience of my life. All right, I'm really proud of this graphic. So there were 97 teams that registered for the hunt. 83 separate teams submitted answers. Sadly, only 82 teams submitted a week. But 70 different teams solved at least 5 puzzles. 58 teams solved at least 1 quest puzzle. 55 teams rescued the linguist in person. That means they were on campus, they came and played with our little box. 49 teams managed to solve at least 1 of the character metas. So for teams that never get to see what a meta puzzle is, 29 teams completed the character endgame, 28 teams solved at least 1 quest meta. So there was a team that never solved the character endgame but actually got some of the quest things done, and 17 teams completed the hunt, which is really sort of the goal of all of this. And be proud of yourself. Why did I make all these slides? I thoroughly enjoyed this. We all did. Literally within
I think the moment you could press the button, Providence Transplantations, of course, submitted throwing swords for the fighter, because as Jen said,
that is your solution to everything.
The fastest solve was solving state dinners 66 seconds after it appeared on their webpage. And the longest solve was IIF solving Hexed Adventure 52 hours after they first released it. The fastest solve on average was Fruitless, which was solved in about 32 minutes. If you haven't looked at it, it's a cute little puzzle by Ben and Sarah. The longest average solve was Tree Rings by Trip, which took 21 hours and was originally a meta puzzle. So, for those of you who wanted a 7-day hunt, we could have done that. Get Her Together was the first one solved. 9 minutes after 1 o'clock, so like 7 minutes into the hunt. And there was one submission 2 minutes before we shut everything down when Test Solution Please solved Smart Move. And now I don't have to talk. Yay! Jen!
Hi. Must get some camera range. So putting on a hunt is expensive. Thank you to all of our sponsors. First, Empirical is an AI startup. You can read all about it here. Empirical's founders include Jim Hunters, Richard Kibitz, and Natasha Manzenga. They are hiring. Please consider being hired by them. They sponsored us and we love them. Jobcase is the company I work for. We run a professional social network that is focused on the 3/4 of the country that does not have a 4-year college degree. It's a really interesting mission, and the people are cool. We're self-funded to 100 people. You can join the network or learn about joining the company at jobcase.com. I would love to have hunters as colleagues. Amazon Web Services, you all know about. We ran the hunt on AWS. It worked great. They're planning to hire lots of people in the next 18 months, a bunch in cloud computing. I use their stuff at work too. Please make my infrastructure work well. Please make Future Hunt's infrastructure work well. We really appreciate their sponsorship. They moved the giant heads for us. If you need a recommendation for a moving company, they can do anything you need in terms of moving giant heads and probably everything else. And last but finally not at all least, the MIT Large Event Fund and Undergraduate Association FinBoard gave us money. We are an undergraduate student group in addition to being an event that includes a whole bunch of non-MIT people as well as MIT people. We would like to maintain that status. I will have a short survey to send the team captains about demographics just so I can report effectively to them. But we really appreciate their sponsorship. MIT lets us use rooms, everything, and all of that is partly because we're a student group. So we appreciate the money, we appreciate the rooms, we appreciate the facility services to clean up all our trash when we're done. So thanks to MIT, LEF, and UA FinBoard. And if you would like to donate next year, you can donate as an individual, you can donate to MIT and it can go to the student group, you can sponsor as a company, and the next team's running team would, I'm sure, very much appreciate your money. Please contact them. Thanks.
I'm now going to do something that I yell at when all my students do, which is read you something that I have on my phone. mostly because we packed up all our printers, so I didn't have time to. Jen and TK talked about a bunch of this when they were talking about like how we design the hunt, but I just sort of wanted to talk about essentially, you know, what our goals were and sort of what, you know, which is sort of tied into like what the hunt means to us, sort of like cuddle, hug sort of thing. So first and foremost, it's that the MIT Hunt is a tradition for MIT students. It is a student organization funded by the school, and the school gives us huge access to rooms and facilities and things where if a conference wanted to come here and do that same sort of thing, they would be paying tens and tens of thousands of dollars. And so it's very much important for us to make sure that the MIT-ness of the hunt sort of is there, and that the hunt is rich with MIT references and MIT puzzles, and that it's really only meant for teams that are here. Yes, we let people who weren't here solve some puzzles, but like they couldn't go to events and they didn't get many points because that wasn't our goal for that. And so when you look at this, like there were 97 teams that registered. I mean, the average team size is just a little bit under 30. And there are a lot of teams that are 5-10 people sitting in one end of East Campus on a floor solving puzzles together. And so if you kind of look at, if you're trying to make every team happy on average, there's a lot of teams that have sort of very differing needs than some of the other teams. Also alluded, we were heavily inspired by a lot of the previous hunts that came before us. As you said, you know, it took us a while to stop calling the character puzzles fish puzzles, because that's what we called them for like 6 months until we went through like this re-education training. They're character puzzles, they're character puzzles. There are no fish in our hunts because like, and one of the things that inspired us there is Jen Burke and I, or I don't know where she just went, we went and spent 3 hours at the student activity fair this year with posters, talking to kids and things like that. And a few kids were like, I've done this like all the year with all the fish puzzles. That was the best hunt ever because there were puzzles I could solve and I didn't feel stupid. And so that there was that sort of goal there. Also, both the Alice Hunt and the Hunted Evil began with like very accessible small rounds that felt like a little hunt. And so those were the things that you're sort of looking at when we did that. And as you can tell, like, we believe that a hunt is about us interacting with you. It was a bit crazy those first 24 hours as we were all running out doing events over and over again, and we didn't actually have time to just visit a team because we just wanted to come by and say hi until sort of like the middle of the second day. But, you know, like, even if you were far away, you know, I mean, I was out at the Waffle House at 2 a.m, you know. It's like, and so for us, it's like, you know, this is really about our time to get to hang out with you and watch you do things and just make sure you're happy. Like, you know, I like that sort of feedback. And you can see that sort of in everything that we did about how we were sort of pulling the hunt together. The same sort of philosophy was true in our events. We wanted to bring people together, but not in sort of a stressful, now solve something, write something, don't look at other people, cover your notes sort of way. Also, I really hope that you felt through the art, the structure, the theme, that this hunt like exuded inadvertently but intentionally a feeling of inclusivity and diversity. And that was very important to us, and we hope that we sort of achieved that. Now the hunt ended after 15 hours.
The coin was found!
Now I put a dollar in the jar! No! I'm old, I've been doing this for 22 years. I left MIT in 1998. Yes, I am old. It's okay. So, for those of you who like looked at the front page of the hunt, or read the little manual while you were sitting there waiting for the hunt to start, you noticed that we had a series of events planned for Saturday, in the morning, in the afternoon, and in the evening. And our goal, we swear, was that the hunt was going to end very, very late. You're not allowed to make it. It's not mean what it says here.
Because you wrote it.
is that the first team would happen upon the coin around the wee hours of the morning on Saturday. I'm not going to talk.
Saturday night.
Yes.
It didn't happen that way. And we're okay with that. But I just want to say that one of the things we did is we made sure that any team that, you know, was like the goal of our events, as we said, it was a rising tide to keep raising everyone's levels up so that everyone could keep seeing things. Because even if you never solved a meta, you would get to see every single character puzzle that way. And so we had contingency plans. So we had ways of making sure that every one of those teams that was going to get to the coin before an event, we made special, we had to do all the same sorts of things, but we ran it just for you. And so you had your own version of Hungry Hungry Hippogriffs and all those sorts of things, because we wanted you to see all those sorts of things. The only thing we couldn't do is we couldn't have the actual heads in our mock races. But I believe most of the teams still went to see that the next day. But overall, like, we are incredibly happy at sort of like the joy that we've seen in everyone, and that so many people got to be part of hunt experiences that they'd only dreamed them and never wanted. And all of you literally have 167 puzzles now that you can leisurely go back and look at, because I doubt you saw all of them over the course of all of this. The other thing, and I'm sort of saying this to everyone in the room and also to our people who have to write next year's hunt sitting here up front, is that I want you all to be very vocal. Like, one of the things we do team surveys, but I think it's very important for everyone who had a good time, everyone who didn't like something, make sure that we are going to create ways that that information can get to you so that you can make a hunt that the people who do the hunt sort of want. And so I want everyone to just sort of make sure that, you know, oh, I'm not going to think about the hunt. I'm like, we're going to make you think about it a little bit, because I want you to make sure that you actually tell this group of people, like, what hunt is to you, so that they can make sure that their vision and your visions are as close together as possible. Please tell me this next slide has nothing to do with me.
Can they only be yes, no?
No!
Yes! You're good.
Maybe not right after.
You'll be very busy looking at all the solution files that you will now have access to.
Is there a full data set on the answer submission going to come
out? Okay, there we go. We have it. Due to an unfortunate event where I erased all of the history on Or Don't We sometime Saturday morning, we need to do a little bit of cleanup from our backup before that is actual data, but we'll have that out alongside the solutions when it's available. On the solution site, the answers will not be visible until you say solution.
Is the way that the puzzles are going to be unlocked visible? I feel like that's a special part of the hunt. I want to see that later.
No. We don't actually have a very legible list of that. It is embedded in a bunch of Java code, and then we intentionally never showed it to you during the hunt so that you would not try to be like, oh, I need to do something with all the things that the cleric unlocked. We did not want you to know anymore what that was once you had it, because there was no meaningful solve information there. none of that is shown right now, because it is totally against what we needed for this event as it ran. Maybe, I don't know.
We have more stuff coming after questions. And there will be
in the red.
We got some root beer at one point.
So we had 5 puzzles that required server resources so that you couldn't just outright hack them. Hex Adventure was pre-planned with a static version. The solution site has that. You can hack it. It's in JavaScript. It is painful for you to hack, but you could. It exists. You will be able to play it. We have similar plans for Crackpot or Snackpot, Tree Rings, and Checkpoint. Show Me the Proof unfortunately relies on resources that we will not be able to have long term and cannot statically host. So that puzzle is gone. I hope you enjoyed it. that one, because it emails you, you cannot statically host it. Dot Matrix and the puzzle at the end of this book, for puzzles that were physically present, will the assets be online? Dot Matrix and the puzzle at the end of this book are both available in digital form on the solution site. So as I told people, and maybe this is not our official stance on it, but as I told people during the hunt, when I went to go visit teams that were still solving on Saturday night into Sunday, the hint structures are designed so that teams that are at the lead don't get too many hints, but at the same time can break through blockages in the solve path in case the hunt is going to go into Monday. It turns out that wasn't very important, and so we tried to make that known to teams as you were still solving on Saturday and on Sunday, that we wanted to help you out, that you were not limited to yes-no questions, that the gold structure is there to provide fairness for leading teams. They were done. We didn't care anymore.
I think we had, all of us, an amazing time on Sunday because we spent most of that day going and visiting smaller teams and poking them on things and helping them with little stuff and teaching them what metas are. And it was a really, really good time for us. So while the teams that were maybe, you know, finished earlier didn't necessarily have a lot of hints available, everybody else did.
Just a few more, maybe?
The question is, did we consider having one of the monsters at the end of this book be Grover? I'm the puzzle constructor on that, so that's why. And the answer is no, because I don't believe he fit, and I really needed a K. Also, you had already seen him, so it would be a little bit weird if he were on the page multiple times.
Was it the number of teams that solve special
FPS?
Maybe.
Let me take that one too. So there was how many teams fully solved, and some are 4, 5, 6. And then another follow-up question about special OPS. I am also the author of that puzzle. There were 5 who solved it. Looking at your submission patterns, I think 2 of you forward solved it. I'm pretty sure most of you back solved it. We do know 4 completes. 4 completes for them.
So now we're done with questions. We'll show you a couple things.
We will be here.
Yeah.
If you have other questions, we will be here afterwards. Come up and ask.
Thank you.
fun. I just want to give a spoiler warning. We're going to talk about two specific puzzles, Hexed Adventure and Basic Phrenology. So if you don't want to be spoiled on those, shut your eyes, plug your ears. Yeah, you're already spoiled on one if you're in the room. Okay.
So real quick, Hexed Adventure was inspired by Hexed Adventure puzzles we've played in Hunt's past, like Say Cheese and Dive, and the Feynman diagram Hexed Adventure. We really enjoyed doing those. We wanted to do something else like that. Zodiac Quest also. So we started very early this year, maybe around like March or so, I think I started writing code for this. And it's a very big puzzle. And I'll let Alex talk more about the size of the content of it. But here are some pictures that we took going around visiting teams of the beautiful maps you drew as you were solving it. And I hope you all enjoyed it.
It's about a 20,000 word puzzle, so thanks for reading our novella length puzzle. I hope you enjoyed it. My favorite story about the solve was IIF, who after finding the coin, sat down to play a game of Catan. And when they looked at the box, they had the aha. Which I think is incredible. So instead of playing, they solved the puzzle. That was a lot of fun to write, very long puzzle to write. The other one that we want to talk about, which started production very early, was Basic Phrenology, where this was also the puzzle with the most incorrect submissions. And the reason for that was I think a lot of people didn't think that the answer might be embedded within the video itself at the end. So after solving a series of clues, you were directed to a specific TED Ed video about counting on fingers, and there was a clue phrase that directed you to the end of that video where you might see something like this. So we got a lot of submissions like chip and binary. The answer itself was encoded in those 13 hands. Each one is giving a binary number, and if you convert those into letters, so 3 to C, which is the top left hand, you can read around craniographer. And the reason that was possible is because I produced all of the TED-Ed lessons, and... Thank you. And I convinced my team to let us do that. All the hands in this video are all of the TED staff throughout, so special thanks to TED for letting us do this.
The chemist, the sad chemist. So there were various interactions. Chris was talking about how at different points of the hunt we wanted to see all the teams. This was the last of the three, which was made up by a bunch of people kind of collaborating about what would be an interesting creative challenge for a team like ours. Also something sort of thematic to the chemist and with this idea of mixology. So. You have three cards that you mix together, and then you have to mix a drink based on that. I don't know if anyone else on the team had any favorites. I know that Off in the Lab made just about the best winged chaotic sling that I've ever had in my life. It's something I feel like I'm going to see on some menus at bars around the area in the future. Anyone else? Anything else people remember from that? No? No? Okay, we can go on. The events. I think Chris was mentioning also about the, so there were the four events. They were planned out. There was this notion that they would be themed on the different six character attributes in classic D&D. I think when I started doing the hunt, which was back in the early 2000s, there was a party that took place. It wasn't really a puzzle, it was just a party at the Friday night part of the hunt where everyone just got together and hung around. They kind of shifted and evolved, puzzles got thrown into them, and at certain points they became a little bit more complicated and in some cases more or less social. In terms of going back to capturing some of that, we figured, well, why not sort of rip off some party games to put together the interactions? I think what's shown there, Certainly the Racing Techies event, which is inspired somewhat by the Washington Nationals Racing Presidents game, for people who love that. Also inspired by an event that happened at MIT back in May. It was the MIT Moving Day
pageant. It was celebrating the 100th anniversary of MIT coming to Cambridge. And Matt McGann, who's over there, who was admitting you to all the events and is also the director of admissions at MIT. he and I were both watching this and back in Maine and said, you know, we should really try to find a way to introduce these into the mystery hunt. And somebody made that. I actually do not know who made these, but we were able to borrow them from Institute events, and your move, as Jen mentioned, moved them for us. But that, hopefully everybody had fun with that. The other events included the Charisma event, which was kind of a mashup between speed dating and Taboo. I do have to ask, any real hookups from the... kind of what I was hoping for, but... then the Hungry Hungry Hippogriffs that was mentioned, it was from a mashup between Hungry Hungry Hippos and sort of Bananagrams type games. And then the Quizardry event at the end, which Todd McClary, who I can't see, he's on the other side of the linguist cell, which he wrote, which is a pub quiz with a twist. After the first round, you thought you knew all the answers, you had it going, and then when the answers were read, you realized that you had been overlooking something and that you actually had to modify the answers before you submitted them. For some of those events, we paired teams together, so hopefully people got to meet each other, socialize a little bit, meet other people beyond just the folks on your team. And now this.
Just working on sound.
Do you need this?
It's not really supposed to come out of this, but... Couldn't have predicted that.
Lowercase. Sorry, type this. No spaces. My song, uppercase, capital, end of spaces, lowercase. All right, I see what you're doing. Well, yes, but.
Okay, wait.
There's a delay with an apostrophe in there. And then type 11 periods. Period, period, period.
Space. Yes. Sorry. This is like my show. I'm sorry.
The word.
and he's totally gonna win.
That was for Elf Dwarf Brawl. If you didn't get to that puzzle, take a look when you get a chance.
Can we pause for this one to have?
Oh, are we?
Oh, yeah.
Before we show this one.
So how much is it?
Okay, got it. No. So, this character up first.
Okay. Very quick rundown of the end games. The end games were made by the same group of people that worked on the merchants. First, there's the character end game. When you completed all of the character metas, the character Mysterio Kantos would come and play a RPG with you, Monsters at Manners, and would let the dungeon master briefly escape his thrall to run the game. The idea is this game involved skill checks where you had to answer trivia questions that turned out to fall into a category related to that character's special ability. And if you did enough trivia questions in a short period of time, you would unveil some of these hexes on the board, which if you did enough of them, they start to look like letters. Do we want to pull them all off, or is that in the video? It's in the video? Okay. So, and the video will show you how that went in practice. We're not doing the video? Okay. Well, then, pull them all up. This is the easier way to win the character ending. And when you released enough of them to be able to see, you found that this actually spelled Hive Mind, which turns out to be the uber special ability where the characters have to work together against Mysterio. And then when you did that, you defeated Mysterio, except he said he never had any intention to let you defeat him, and he ran off to the foreboding Final Fortress. Ooh. The foreboding, and we're not doing the video for that either. Well, that we did the runaround, right? Okay. The foreboding Final Fortress. There's some relations between them. The idea was that the sort of character endgame was a small RPG on a small board, like you'd be playing an RPG. And when you made it to the final endgame, it was a full-size in-person one. Also, for this, we came to you. For this, you had to come to us. So. Mysterio, who was played by many, many people over the course of the weekend, and we all had a lot of fun insulting you, would stand in the middle, and the six characters would stand on their icons. This time, Mysterio only asked you one question, and it was not really a fair question, because it was something like, what magician am I thinking of? So the wizard. However, if you'd been paying attention in the first endgame, all of the wizard questions, since they were when the wizard uses owl familiar, contained who. And so it turned out the wizard's answer, what magician is am I thinking of, is Houdini. When you got that, you would turn over this hex and discover there was a number underneath, including some that were two numbers, which were not 61, most teams, but a 6 and a 1. Those gave numbers from 1 to 8 for all of the characters. You also, at this point, had the items from the merchants, which gave you modifiers, like +3 and -7. This meant, since each of the numbers 1 to 8 you were assigning to a character who also had a modifier, you had a sequence of 8 modifiers, with 2 of them used twice. In the previous interaction, you gained the ability Hive Mind, which was not enough this time. But if you applied these modifiers to Hive Mind in order, H-I-V-E, and shifted them appropriately, you got the thing you needed to finish off Mysterio Kantos, Group Hug. And so the 6 people came and hugged their dungeon master friend, and through the power of friendship, drove Mysterio Kantos away. If only they could get to the two-sided die before he could. And what? Oh, wait. How did they get it? Well, when Mysterio stepped off this thing, there was one final adventure written by the dungeon master when he could kind of get Mysterio out of his head briefly. And so the people doing the runarounds, rather than getting something underneath, they actually took this hex with them as we went, which we thought would be a nice visual. Let's see if it is.
Your final adventure begins now, but you must hurry. You begin by finding your magical gold dispensary across from the ruins of an ancient treasury. Are we looking for an ATM? Okay, this is a runaround.
Yes.
So yeah, before we end, we have one last thing to show you, and this is compiled from a lot of things that you showed us. You might recognize a lot of your faces or your friends here.
And thank you all.
Just a few small announcements. There is one thing I was asked to, and we were asked to announce, which is that if you really like puzzles, there are lots of puzzle events that go on throughout the year, including June 3rd, is that what I heard? There is the Boston Area Puzzle Hunter League Baffle, is what we call it, and you can go to baphl.org to find more information about that. Also, around me, there are a number of different items that were used during Hunt, and we don't really have much intention of using those again. So if people are looking for souvenirs, including maybe large hex tiles, we have additional copies of tokens, additional puzzles at the end of this book. So if you didn't get a book with a puzzle at the end of it, that makes some of you like, if you ever wanted your own impenetrable cell, we have a couple of those. Some of these things you can come and look at the inside. You can see how it works if you want. There are some things there are a few of, and some things there are lots of. So there may be some negotiation around that. But we would certainly love for you to come, and if there's anything that you see that you really like, to come and take it home with you.
Yes.
Yes, if you have not cleaned your rooms, it's very important to do so. I think thank you to most of you for cleaning your rooms. We did a check this morning, and I believe we saw nearly all of them. So thank you very much on that. As was pointed out before, this is kind of a crazy event for a university to have nearly 2,000 people descend on the campus and use it day and night the entire weekend. And so we really do rely on
the good graces of MIT and the fact that they, many people at MIT really do love this event and want to see it go on. So thank you again.
Just one
It was all in my turn.
I'm tired. Just one last thing so that you can wander off and do your things or come down here and see us for a little bit is I just want to congratulate Death and Mayhem, which are pretty much, you know, the compilation of two teams that I've been watching the hunt for, because this is my 22nd hunt. And so it's sort of really special to see a bunch of people, and I'm really excited for what you're going to do. And we're all here to help you in any way you can, possibly not during the next week, as I try to keep my other job. But I just really want to congratulate you on your spirit, your enthusiasm, how much fun it was to interact with you and with everyone, and I'm really excited for next year.
This address is linked from monsters@menace.com, both on your main map, or if you don't have an account or you want to share it with friends, on the login screen. We had DNS problems this morning, so this is what it is. but like I said, it's linked. The word here will take you there, and we'll try and get that resolved a bit nicer over time.
Thank you.